Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. Dr. Rena Malik, urologist and pelvic surgeon here. Today we are going to be talking about bladder medications, specifically medications for overactive bladder. Are they safe? Are they effective? Well, stick around because you're going to find out. So first off, what exactly is overactive bladder? Well, overactive bladder is a constellation of symptoms or group of symptoms that include urgency or the sensation that you have to rush to the bathroom and you can't hold off, frequency, having to go to the bathroom more often than usual, and what the definition that we use in urology is more than 8 times in 24 hours, and urgency urinary incontinence or leakage of urine that occurs with that sudden desire to go to the bathroom that you can't delay, and nocturia or waking up at night to urinate. I've talked about 5 easy things you can do for your overactive bladder without medication before. I've also talked about bladder irritants, which are things that can cause symptoms of overactive bladder, so make sure you check those 2 videos out. If you've done all those things and you're still having some of these symptoms, the next step in the pathway of treatment is to try some medications. So I'm going to talk about the 2 classes of medications for overactive bladder. And the 2 different types of medication that you might see are a group of medications called anticholinergics. Some names you might see are oxybutynin, tropium, tolteridine, sulfafenicin, and there's lots of different kinds. And then there's beta-3 agonists. And the only one that we have out on the market right now is called Mirabegron. So I'm gonna talk about each of these medications, and I'm gonna talk about at the very end, the latest research linking these anticholinergics to dementia. Is it real? Is it something you need to worry about? Make sure you stick around to the end of the video to find out. So the way anticholinergics work is they bind to a receptor on the bladder wall. And when they do that, they inhibit anything in the body from binding to that receptor. And normally when the body does bind a molecule to that receptor, it causes the bladder to contract. So this is inhibiting bladder contractions or squeezing. So what you can imagine then is if this receptor is not able to be activated, you're having less strong contractions, so you're decreasing the contractions, which will subsequently decrease the amount of urgency that you feel or that strong desire to go and how severe that urge is when you get it. It will also give you more time to get to the bathroom so you have less accidents, and it will increase the size of your bladder, and it will give you more time between voids. So if you're going very often during the day, it will give you some more space between needing to rush to the bathroom. And so does it really work? Well, when you look at the studies, they compared giving these medications compared to placebo or like a sugar pill. And indeed, they found that people taking anticholinergics did have less incontinence, less urgency episodes, less frequent voids, and had a larger volume voided per micturition, which means that when they go to the bathroom, they're emptying more volume of their bladder. So that kind of is a surrogate for telling you how big your bladder is or how much urine your bladder can hold. Great. So these medications work. So why aren't people with overactive bladder taking these medications all the time? Well, there are some really significant side effects. These can include blurry vision, constipation, dry eyes, dry mouth, and some cognitive changes. So people may have decreased attention and reaction time and may have a little bit of decrease in their short-term memory. So this doesn't happen to everybody, but it certainly can happen. So these medications are not given to people who already have some baseline signs or symptoms of changes in their cognition or their brain activity. Also, you can't get these medications if you have any sort of urinary retention. You can check out my last video on urinary retention where I react to house to learn a little bit more about that. Also, if you have narrow angle glaucoma, and I'm not the right person to tell you about narrow angle glaucoma, so ask your ophthalmologist if you have that, because that would preclude you from getting this medication if you potentially needed it, or if you have what's called gastroparesis. And gastroparesis is when your gut is slow in digesting the food you eat. So when you look at the data on anticholinergics, you'll find that almost 60% of people will stop taking anticholinergics by 6 months. So why is that? Well, one, maybe it's not efficacious. 2, because of the side effects that they might notice, the ones that I just talked about. 3, because they feel like they wanted to try to get by without it and they felt fine without it, so they did. 4, because they don't want to take medications forever, or 5, because they didn't really know there were other treatment options, so they just stopped and they didn't ask for anything else. So I think the big take home from that is if you get put on a bladder medication, it's important you follow up because there are other treatment options and there are other ways that we can help improve your overactive bladder without medication. So moving on to the second kind of medication, which is called a beta 3 agonist, or again, the name is Mirabegron, of the only medication that's on the market in the United States right now. And how this medication works is it actually binds to a receptor and it mimics what would normally bind to that receptor and it causes the bladder to relax. So this medication works by causing a decrease in what we call sensory urgency, or the sensation or feeling that you gotta go, and also increases your bladder capacity, or makes it bigger and allows it to hold more. This medication has very few side effects. The one that we caution all patients on are making sure you check your blood pressure about a week after starting. It can increase your blood pressure very slightly by about 10 millimeters of mercury, but we do want you to check and make sure that you don't fall into a category where your blood pressure is too high. Other side effects can include a stuffy nose or headaches. You do want to check with your doctor if you're on any medications that you might need to adjust with this medication. The most common medication that does sometimes require some adjustment of the dose you're taking is a medication called a beta blocker, or metoprolol, toprol, things like that. Generally speaking, this medication is really well tolerated and a lot of people do pretty well on it. The issue is that it is still a brand name medication, which sometimes makes it costly based on insurance. And so despite having a little bit of a better side effect profile, sometimes people can't afford it and have to try the other class of medications. Okay, so I promised at the beginning of this video that I would talk about the linkage of anticholinergics with dementia. Where does that come from? Does that hold any weight? And should you be concerned about it? Well, there were two major studies that were published relatively recently that go into some significant detail on the linkage of dementia with anticholinergic medications. And I'm going to go through both of them. So the first study was published in the British Medical Journal in 2018. And what they did was they looked at a big research database that they had, and they found 40,000 people with dementia, age 65 and above. And they paired them up with other people in that same database who were very similar to them in age, other medical problems, other conditions that were important, and they matched them up and they compared the two groups, either with dementia and without dementia. And what they specifically looked at was the medications they were on anywhere between 4 and 20 years before getting the diagnosis of dementia. They did try to control for what's called confounding factors. And confounding factors are basically things that could actually be causing or related to the dementia that might also be commonly seen in people who are taking anticholinergics. So they looked at things like age, smoking, medications, other things that might also cause dementia. And what they found specifically was that bladder medications were associated with a higher risk of getting dementia if they took bladder medications anytime between the 4 and 20 years prior to getting diagnosed with dementia. I think the big criticism of this study is, one, it's retrospective, meaning it's looking at a database, it's not prospective. 2, we also don't know if they were able to control for all confounding factors, because really we don't know what causes dementia. And we also can't control for if they took the medication or if they took any over-the-counter anticholinergic medication. So there are over-the-counter anticholinergic medications available, at least in the United States. And so some people could be taking them who were in the not dementia group. The other theory that goes along with a lot of this data is that there may be something similar in the group of people who get anticholinergics and the group of people who get dementia, meaning that the actual cause, for example, bladder symptoms, might be preceding their dementia, because we do know that bladder symptoms are sometimes the very first sign of a neurologic problem in some conditions like multiple sclerosis. So it might be that this is actually an indicator of dementia. And if your bladder symptoms are bad enough, it may be that this is the first symptom that you're going to see. So again, we don't know enough. I think it's hard to really say that one causes the other. All we know is that there is a correlation. So should that stop you from taking medications that might improve your quality of life? I think it's up to you to decide that. But I tell people, if your quality of life is really that poor, then you should really consider taking medications that might help you. The next study was actually very similar to this first one. It was published in the Journal of the American Medical Association. And they, again, were a group out of England that looked at nearly 60,000 people who had dementia and compared them with a bunch of controls, so nearly 250,000 controls who were, again, matched to the people with dementia. And so then they, again, compared them. And what was different about the study was they looked at total standardized daily dosing. So they said, how much anticholinergic do you need to take for their correlation to exist with dementia? Again, I'm not saying causation because we don't know if it's causing dementia or not, but we do know that there is a correlation. And so how much, and what they looked at and found was that actually 3 years or total standardized daily dosing of equivalent of 3 years was correlated with dementia. Again, this study was limited in the older population above 65 years of age, and they looked at, again, using anticholinergics for any period of time from 11 years prior to the diagnosis up until the diagnosis. While these both are really excellently and well done studies, I think ultimately we still don't know what causes dementia, and it's really hard to say if anticholinergics specifically are causing dementia or there's some combined confounding factor that is common in both groups. So again, I think that the same take home applies is that yes, there is a correlation, so you want to use it with caution. I would tell you if you notice any changes in yourself or your family member who's taking an anticholinergic, like they're forgetful, they've changed some factor in their cognitive mindset, then I would try to take them off those medications. And you should review your medications every time you see your doctor and say, hey, why am I on this? What is this doing for me? Do I really need this medication? Because there are certain medications like anticholinergics, which people will put you on for bladder symptoms. You'll forget why you're on it, and you may not even be really receiving that much benefit from it. So you do need to kind of reevaluate your medications every time you see your doctor. And lastly, what I want to let you guys all know is that there are third line therapies for overactive bladder. These include Botox injections in the bladder, a bladder pacemaker called sacral neuromodulation, or there are treatments based in acupuncture called posterior tibial nerve stimulation, which is basically similar to acupuncture that helps improve overactive bladder. And so these things I can talk about in future videos. If you are interested, please let me know down below. Thank you so much for watching. I really appreciate you. If you enjoyed this video, make sure you subscribe and hit that notification bell so you don't miss my new videos every Monday. And always remember to take care of yourself because you're worth it.